And because he was too lazy, Mike, to do his SDR talk yet, so... Which reminds me, I put it in the slide, when are you ready to do your talk?
In March.
In March, okay. So, when in March?
After the 6th. So after the 6th and before the
19th. Okay. We'll see. Otherwise, we are always open for other people to talk. I know Lime's got a master's at the moment, so he's not going to talk anytime soon. And
well, you have to hear all about my master's like every month. And that'll get boring quick, I think.
I'm busy, so I'm not going to talk often. And then if you want to have us over to do this somewhere else but here, let us know. Just a reminder again, Mike. No pressure. And then B-Sides Cape Town might need some volunteers in the future. Ross is taking a step back. And Grant will be moving to Texas at the end of the year. So he won't be leading it anymore. And I think Yeston's sort of going to take over. But always need more people to help out with organizing and sponsors and stuff like that. Any questions? Ideas? Anyone want to talk soon except Mike?
Keith mentioned you might.
Keith. Yeah. So yeah, Keith's mentioned a couple of times, but he goes overseas quite a lot. So just remember that. And I'll rope my brother in at some point, hopefully. So I'm just going to talk about the reason I've actually got this device is that there's a company out in Montague Gardens that does LED lighting and stuff like that, and they're trying to build a home automation system, but they only have a bunch of Windows developers, so they had no idea what Linux actually did. So I just went and poked around a bit and took one home, and I kind of told them to throw it away, or just brand new firmware, which I found a couple of links for, but I haven't even really got into it. And then it was actually interesting because, I mean, we've all read about the Mariah botnet a couple of months ago, and then when I actually started looking around, I found that this was exactly one of the devices that was actually being hit. And funny enough, you find less of them on the internet now because they've been hit by Mariah, but I'll get to that at some point. And so I just looked at like what I thought they did wrong, and what the device could do. So it looks like that. When it's here, it's not got much to look at. So it's an ARM chip with a USB Wi-Fi, so you actually have to connect to it through a USB interface, and it's got a CMOS, forget which one, it'll be on a slide soon. And then like you can see in the photo, some of them can actually pan and tilt. So it's a very common device in China that's been, I can't say pirated, shared across many companies. And they all do different variations of it, different quality CMOS sensors, extra devices they put on it, and how you connect it. So to actually find any info on this is quite painful because you'll find 400 different implementations of it. I just happened to find the exact photo, so I was lucky. I'm not even sure if that's what goes inside that. So once again, it's not a bad chip. It's got 128 megabytes of RAM, flash, ARM chip. So by now you can probably guess it's running Linux, as I said before. And it has an encryption chip as well. I forgot about that. I didn't really go into it, but it does have a file called encryption with obviously the way that you would interface with it. And it gets really hot as well for a little chip like it. And running on it is Linux kernel 3.0.8, obviously compiled for ARM. with BusyBox and U-Boot, so you can actually, while it's booting and you're connected to it by serial, you can actually cancel its boot and go into U-Boot, change the environment variables and boot it off the first memory address, and it'll go through its normal boot. When it boots, mounts a bunch of firmware images and different directories. What I didn't like was that they built a lot of custom binaries to manage stuff like Wi-Fi. They did use some open source libraries for the sensor, audio codecs and stuff, but often they would just build their own sort of monolithic binary to control everything, like changing the Wi-Fi access, which is not as simple as it seems, and there's no documentation for it. I guess you have to buy it to actually know how to do it. And a lot of them have cloud management capabilities, which is already a warning sign. Hard-coded Chinese credentials and IPs. And then from U-Boot, you can get TFTP going. Telnet and HTTP is already running on it, and then the video protocols. And yeah, so it'll have some of the nice features that it actually has is it can actually track movement and notify you of it with infrared and the normal CMOS and motor control and all of that. And this was sort of the general idea behind all of it. It's the same way that I got to actually network with it. There's a stupid app called HomeC that you have to set the device into a sort of reset mode where it sets up its own access point, and then the app will actually discover it on your and connect it to your Wi-Fi network via the cloud. Or so you can't actually do this without having an internet connection. It has to go through some Chinese server to then give it the credentials and everything, and it's probably all running over HTTP. I haven't actually snuffed any of it. You can guess that that encryption chip's not used there yet. Often when I look through the settings, AES and stuff like that on the Wi-Fi was actually set to none or null, unless they actually switch it on when it's booting. And then obviously it's got BusyBox and a HTTP server. This one didn't have curl, but it had wget running on it, which is nice. And the problems started coming around quickly. Krebs on Security covered this as well. He has a whole list of passwords, which this one was on there. And all over the internet, you'll find the passwords for these and their cousins. And then also, although it failed earlier, the actual streaming of the video, I didn't need any auth to get onto that, which seemed a bit crazy to have auth on all your HTTP and your telnet and everything and then screw the video. I suppose that's where all those lovely cameras come from on Shodan. And then luckily with the password, obviously you can get in, either through serial, which I started with, and then eventually when you actually get it onto your LAN, you can telnet to it. And as you can see, everything's running as root. So obviously any code injection or execution is going to happen on the root level. And I looked quite a lot at a lot of what they were doing was JavaScript running on that THTTP server, then executing bash scripts that then execute the C binaries. I want to say that's what you see a lot in the embedded world. It's not my first choice, if I'm honest, especially if it's not escaped or evaluated or anything. Anything you can pass just breaks whatever it's interpreting. And like you can see, telnet's running. This was a binary that I didn't have time to actually reverse engineer or look at, but you can guess that's how they're doing all the setting up the Wi-Fi and connecting to their cloud servers, because that's what had most of the ports actually open to it, if you look through Netstat. So just to walk you through what they've done, in terms of just basic Linux setup, a lot of it seems unnecessary and crazy, but obviously I am the root, and a lot of the files you'll actually see all over the place more than once, and a lot of config files. With lovely Chinese IP address ranges for DNS, which obviously helps it get the Wi-Fi credentials. Actually, even more fun than going through that is when you start actually looking at the web server that it has. So you can either connect to it via your phone and stream the video down. This will work. Come on. But the first madness that you find is that all of the files are pretty much accessible as much as you want, and all the lovely code executions. So wonderful AJAX calls to what ends up being a bash script. So lovely bash scripts capturing all of the JavaScript input and then passing it to the C binaries. The one I had the most fun with, but not 100% luck with yet. Looks like that, and that $1 can be a lot of fun, reboots or changing the password or whatever you want to do. So I mean, like, even though the password's already online, just scratching around in all of their JavaScript. In fact, this one had the least amount of features. Others had configuring it from its interface. The favorite one that I found was that it had a FTP feature, and actually reading or putting files via the FTP would evaluate whatever command that you sent it. So the FTP would actually change the password for you. Let's see if I can find that encryption. Obviously the password file in an ugly they had a firmware update configuration which you couldn't actually use, and you'd have to actually get U-boot running to actually update it. So good luck. Where was that? Easy encryption. Yeah, so pretty much everything as root, code injection, you can see the files from the actual HTTP server, and a lot of fun. And this was actually a device that recently got sold to the client that I was talking to. So it's not like they've got any updates coming anytime soon. In fact, you could find the change log, the readme, a file called ping.html that would just return pong. So probably the intern writing this. Let's see if we can actually get the stream. But if you really want to see that, you can come and check on my phone later. So obviously the usual OWASP top 10 prevalent in most of these devices. Some of them are even worse as they try and add more features. Obviously each one tries to have a different interface to look like they're all different, and the company anyway, and then even more fun is if you're on Alibaba, you can actually get publicly accessible ones on the internet that you can play around with in different megapixel strengths and configurations. So often the underlying CPU will be the same, but they'll change the CMOS sensors, Wi-Fi, stuff like that, depending on what kind of camera it actually is. Some were mounted for security purposes, others that you would actually just put next to your baby while it's sleeping so that you can keep an eye on it. And the thing is, it's not just them. With the Maria botnet, the problem with the Maria botnet is that default credentials were the easiest way to get in. Where it got really interesting is if you actually go read the source code, as soon as they've gotten in on a device, they actually closed Telnet and some of the other services so you can't get in and take over the device again. So they've actually improved the security for you, but it's already screwed. And then beyond that, because it's a Linux machine, it's got BusyBox. They've limited some of BusyBox, but you've got a lot of things on it already. Wget, I think Netcat was on it. You've got FTP, Telnet. There's a obvious reason that this botnet grew and was a bit of a problem. And then if you actually look at the CNC as well, it was interesting because the exploit code was more C, and then the CNC was written in Golang, so obviously they were expecting a flood of incoming requests from the devices, because only they can actually control it now. So you probably want to keep it going. But not just, it wasn't just interesting. Well, obviously default credentials is the easy way to go. Some of the exploits you would see were command injections, and even Maria was using workarounds for stuff like Cloudflare, working around NAT, Nginx proxying, stuff like that, so that they could still get to the devices and get back. Some interesting ideas behind it. Even more interesting is that they were they were limiting the IP ranges that they would actually attack as well. So none of the US government, Air Force, Army, some of the big telecoms. So they would focus more on sort of home devices and stay away from ranges where they like get discovered and get into trouble. And then which actually bothers me because I've got an Asus router at the moment and I need to actually update the software. Sort of a lot of the same issues show up with routers as well, BusyBox, Linux, and ARM devices. I mean, that's pretty horrendous from Netgear, where you could just send it literally anything and it would execute on that CGI. And then if you want to go look at Shodan's D-Link report, that's really fun because there's still 430,000 odd devices still vulnerable and on the public internet that they give you access to. And D-Link's actually denied it, where Asus and Netgear sort of took the seriousness of the situation and patched it. D-Link is being sued by the FTC, I think. So that's a lot of fun. More reading, and I should have put another link. My conclusion for the device, I know it's a sort of a quick talk, but that's the idea. Mike will give us an in-depth talk. He's actually the hardware guy, I'm just the hobbyist. Not now, when you've got your SDR working. It gets a 1 out of 5 stars from me.
Oh, so you still on some level recommend it, though.
Well, it's a really nice device. I mean, it's pretty fast for a Linux device. It's got a lot of RAM. I mean, the things that you could do with it are amazing. You'd obviously have to trash the firmware and start from scratch. I mean, there's no point ever we felt like the device was running too slow or connecting to it was too slow or the video was lagging or anything like that. Even the sensor without a lens on it, you can still see that it's decent, and it costs fairly low. It's just that the hardware is good, the software is not good, and the fix would be that. And that's about it. Questions?
So if there wasn't a default admin and password, or this way, do you think that if as part of the setup, the initial when you power this thing on, the first thing it asks you is change the admin password? Do you think that would have made a big difference? Would that have made your life harder?
Yeah.
Would that have made the botnet Maria?
Yeah, that would have made it harder, but the fact that there's no other users, no groups, none of the access controls that you usually get with Linux out of the box are there.
Yeah.
So the web server still running is root. If you find any code injection, anything on the web server, it's gone.
That wouldn't solve the problem anyway, though, because the root...
I didn't say solve the problem, I said make it harder.
Well, not really, though, because...
That's an awesome question. Would it?
It wouldn't, though, because the web interface is the only thing that it would prompt you to maybe change the password, but that doesn't change the password of the... I don't know about all of them, but I know that on some at least, it doesn't change the password of the user account.
This one never really had the option to even change the password unless you knew what you were doing, connected by a serial telnet to change it. And then there's still one account running everything. And you can see the reason why it's running is root, because the guy wasn't sure if what he was doing was going to work. Because some of the stuff he was doing was a bit low level, like controlling some of the pins in the board. So, I mean, with enough time, you could have fixed that, but he obviously got pushed for a deadline.
What's the next one?
Is there like a standard distro that they used, or where did the distro come from?
No idea. There's so much like different firmware files that you get out there. I sort of just didn't go down that route. I mean, most people just said, download this TFPT. And just like wreck it, start over. And some US guys have started doing their own firmware for it because it's a decent device. It's just you can't connect it up to anything reliably and hope that that you're not going to get screwed.
So is the hood mounted read only or read write?
Some of it is read only, but a lot of it is write as well. So let me think, what was read only? A lot of the stuff in the CGI bin was read only. But they can't do everything read only because they're doing stuff like snapshots where you take a photo and actually store it in temp. And they're mounting stuff in temp, so it was a all over the place kind of business.
Of course, that where I work, we have a device which is a router plus a chip that we use squash FS on that, so it's only read only.
Mm.
So you, if you want to update it, you have to actually reflash it.
Yeah, so I mean, a lot of the changes, initially I just started changing configurations here and there. As soon as it reboots, it pretty much wipes everything and remounts it off the firmware image, so you lose a lot of that.
So assuming you use the Unix file permissions and you go least privilege necessary and the web server now runs as web server D or something like that, etc. And you've changed the password, would making it listen, well, the admin functionality, maybe on the like the private IP ranges only, would that help? Would that make life harder for the attacker? Well,
yeah,
specifically
so
across, specifically I'm thinking botnet again, not the guy sitting there and going into U-boot and going,
so
okay, let's look what's happening there. But
a lot of the sort of manuals were going on UPnP and actually connecting it out to the internet. And, well, I mean, the fact that it's already connecting out to cloud servers, one of the security firm actually was targeting their DNS servers and then spoofing the DNS so that the users would actually connect to them and send them usernames and passwords. So keeping it off the internet is the first step, but to get it to work, you have to be on the internet.
Yeah. Some of the design decisions, like being able to
monitor
this thing
for your
phone.
So I mean, it's an Internet of Things device. The whole point was to put it on the internet. But there's way too much escalation going on in that.
Well, too much running its route, no encryption, blah, blah, blah.
Could you reiterate what you meant by you need to connect it to the internet to be able to get it?
So it was running sort of in AP mode, but as a hidden SSID. So the app would be able to pick up on it, but then I would have to be connected to the internet to get it to the cloud server to hit it on UDP and then set the.
So I assume then there's no LAN interface.
If you get the device, not
but that
pull
one,
the
that
part,
one
it would have a LAN interface. Depending on the model.
Yeah.
So some of them you could actually set up the right way.
Yeah.
But potentially it would still have to go through a cloud server.
Because I had a more advanced one, if I could put it that way, that my dad's friend needed to have fixed, and it had a LAN port.
And
it was
pretty
easy to just do a network scan, find the IP address, and then connect to it that way.
And then obviously further research would have been to look at this because it's changing the Wi-Fi AP for you via UDP from a cloud server. So that would also be running as root with all kinds of madness inside of it.
It's a privacy concern for me that all the images are being sent to China. So wherever you put it, there's no privacy.
So this one was actually not set up that much around cloud. The others you can back up to the cloud.
Yeah.
So it's pretty much like a big fire hose of your information going out to China. And let's be honest, that's where a lot of the hardware is being made. So we have a difficult choice. You either spend 10,000 Rand on a decent camera or 1,000 Rand on a Chinese camera. But I mean, that's where companies can come in and write proper software for it. I mean, it's an ARM device. It's not a completely custom architecture. Yes.
Why is it actually on the internet then? It should be behind a firewall or something. So how are people putting it on the internet so you can actually access it? Are they just opening like a VNAT or something?
So a lot of the documentation had different ways of doing it. And so yeah, and a lot of the documentation was horrible as well, badly written and spelled. And so
yeah.
Anyone else?
I haven't really read into it, but maybe you might have. Kaspersky OS. I read that it's supposed to be aimed at IoT devices with the operating system with security in mind.
But do you trust Russian developers?
No, it's not do I not trust Russian developers, it's do you trust something that's completely proprietary and claims to be 100% secure from the start. So in terms of that, we already have enough people doing Internet of Things OSs. Google has Android-based one at the moment.
No, but like from my understanding, it's completely rewritten from scratch. No Linux.
Yeah, so it's not Linux.
Yeah.
So what is it then?
Well, it's their own.
But that's his point.
So that's going to go as well as Windows, right?
well, potentially.
Windows IoT.
Who knows? Yeah.
So. No, they're trying to do it as closed source as possible. But everyone else is doing a IoT OS already and doing it open source, so why do it that way? I mean, you've got Ubuntu Snappy Core, you've got Google, you've got 100. You can even do just OpenWRT or, what's my favorite one?
DWRT.
Docker just moved away from Ubuntu onto that.
Alpine, that's the one. Yeah.
So Alpine Linux is also a good way to go. I mean, that's really designed for routers and stuff like that. It'll probably have double the features that Kaspersky will be able to do in 2 years.
It is quite tricky though, isn't it? I mean, I'm a Linux fan myself, but companies like CentOS, they had problems in the past because at one point it was only being developed by a few developers. The main one who basically had a nerve breakdown disappeared, and they needed to make some changes on the operating system. They couldn't find it without the money. So that's where the difficulties lie. It's open source, but it's better than a system where everything is hidden away from you, and no one's telling you the truth. Especially when you've got these monolithic operating systems that most of them are really complicated to understand. And you're just putting one bug on another.
Although, especially in sort of embedded, or at least as far as I know embedded stuff, they often take the same sort of trend as Red Hat with older kernels. So I mean, that's 3.0.8, Linux is at 4.4.8. So even though the newer Linux has a lot more driver support, fixes and stuff, when these devices were developed, they've got everything already in there, and you can just security patch them as you go. So, I mean, the base OS is done for you. Screwing up the development on top of that is what they're doing. I mean, is there any harm in adding another user, except for root?
Yeah, I think it's what you said. It's clearly that they're basically for the people, but they're not paying very much. And it's not being properly peer reviewed.
But I mean, you also see the same kind of mistakes at Netgear and D-Link and everyone. So maybe learn from each other, do a framework.
I've seen a lot of SDKs that the companies that make a chip hand out are pretty bad like that as well.
Yeah.
And I can't remember which one it was, but I was working with some little sort of SOC type thing. And
and the SDK was completely insecure. It's great as a router, and people literally just compiled it and chucked it on the device. That was the end of the. I mean, everything was default. The when you opened up the serial port, you just had to do access without any authentication and stuff like that. So I think even the frameworks are pretty bad.
That's true. I mean, we discovered this afternoon that there is a port scanning against a TP linkage for some reason or other. UPnP was still enabled. We couldn't understand why the connection time was port based because of UPnP.
Yeah.
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 But I mean, given the proliferation of all the devices, I think it's actually going to get any better. So is it? It just this people are mass producing these things and spreading it all over. It's just going to be worse.
Yeah. So, DEFCON last year had a lot of Bluetooth devices, and the companies would on their website and on their videos say the first 100% secure Bluetooth lock, and then the difference between being the owner of the house and the guest that you added on. So the only problem is because of the cloud services that power everything, you have to be added onto the lock or whatever device. But as soon as you were on, the difference was a query string that said master versus admin or something like that, master versus guest. And you changed it to master and you were a master as well. So if you've got encryption, and you can still just send a parameter, null and void.
But I was quite alarmed to hear from a friend of mine who does banking software that's on GitHub. A lot of people who use AWS have been uploading their private keys.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
That's been going on a couple of years, yeah.
I think you're in a bit locked there for a minute.
Yeah, I think bot stacks.
Yeah. Has no one heard of gitignore?
Yeah.
Well, the thing is that AWS actually scanned GitHub constantly for access keys and will notify the owner of that key if it's found. So if you're unlikely to do that, you'll get notified. But you may either have a very big bull by that domain, or you could have everything in your account deleted by that point.
And to some extent, that's why you have IAM roles anyway, so
yes,
that you don't have to drop it into your code every time.
But as we all know, people don't read docs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Look, I mean, at the end of the day, it's a human problem.
Yeah.
First, and then it's a hardware problem, and then it's a this problem. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I was wondering if there any PCB work that probably with microkernels and function items like garage books,
Not yet. I really got into it, but. In China, they use what everyone else is using so far. So, hopefully, startups. There's a great documentary that Vice did on YouTube about Shenzhen, where American companies move the whole company to Shenzhen into a startup hub for 6 months until they get the product done, and then they move them back to the US. So, that's hopefully where things like that will actually come out. Because, I mean, even a lot of what's running on that is wasted. I mean, there's a lot of busy box tools you're never going to use in that.
Well, the trouble that I've seen a number of times with these embedded devices is that the SoC manufacturers go, here's the chip, here's part of a data sheet, the rest you can maybe see if you use sign an identical crazy NDA, and then you'll get a Linux kernel and a binary driver for parts of the chip that are specific to them, and that's it. So you basically can't upgrade the kernel.
Yeah.
You can't do anything but run Linux because there is no other drivers for that thing. And it tends to be on the cheaper chips. And that was one of the complaints with the Raspberry Pi, is that its video chip was completely proprietary. Info has since been released, and there is now an open source video driver, but it's not the same.
Yeah, and the funny thing is, when I went into, for instance, proc CPU info, the serial number for the ARM chip is 00000. So I'm going to guess that they didn't even get all the data sheets the right way. So how good is the ARM support if they're not even paying the licensing to ARM, which is minimal compared to putting an Intel chip in there or anything like that. And, you know, rinse and repeat. I could take another chip and it would be the same story.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's a great device. It's fast, it's got a lot of capabilities, but it's just been bludgeoned to death to get it through a deadline. Anyone else? There's still beers, so let's be social. And yeah, this talk was just to actually kick off the year in between me working and looking at this device. So he'll do an SDR talk. I can't emphasize it enough, which will be amazing, much better than mine, because he's actually the hardware guy. And if SDR,